Hey everybody, my name is Rob Woodbridge from Untethered.tv. What you're about to see here is a clip, a short clip of a much longer episode. It can be found on Untethered.tv. So if you really are interested in this, go to Untethered.tv, do a search for this title, and you'll find it there. But enjoy this short clip. Throughout your research for the book, and from what you've seen since the book was published, obviously, you know, as you said earlier, there's been a pull from mobile, right? You know, during the internet days, it was a push. You had to convince somebody that they needed a website. You had to convince somebody that they needed to get online. But with mobile, we kind of woke up one day and there were 5 billion connected devices around the world, and smartphones accelerating, and everybody experimenting. So obviously, this has had a huge influence on the way that we use these to self-track and to create our virtual self. How big is this phenomenon? How far does this stretch? Is this a North American thing, or are we seeing this around the world?
Well, I mean, one of the things that I think is the most interesting in the book is uncovering research about using cell phone data in particular in the developing world. And so in this case, we're generally not talking about smartphones, we're talking about ordinary feature phones. But there's some really interesting research that's been done by people like Nathan Eagle and people out of MIT into the idea of like, well, if you can anonymize the data about where people are, what are some of the things that you can learn? And so they've used it to do things like track and not even track, but predict where malaria outbreaks are going to happen based on the movement of anonymized cell phone data. And this is a feature of how quickly cell phones have been spread through the developing world. So you take a country like Kenya, for instance, and cell phone penetration rates amongst people, I think between the ages of about 15 and 60, are very close to 100%. So you're talking about suddenly this location-based data being potentially very useful, precisely in contexts where more formal information might not be available. Or there has been incredible use of cell phone data in Haiti after the crisis there to track things like the spread of cholera and where people are going and that kind of thing. And obviously, I mean, it raises huge questions about privacy. Sorry, there's a plane going overhead. Huge questions about privacy and how you protect people's data and whether anonymous data that can really truly be anonymous, or whether there are risk factors there, and I think the research suggests that there are risk factors there. But I think you're looking at something that might be, in fact, globally transformative once you start to think about what you can use this information for.
And I mean, we're seeing this, you know, from a commercial standpoint. A lot of people are trying to take the location data and use it to sell goods, or you know, to geofence or to get trends, traffic trends, and people trends, and you know, when you look at what happens in developing nations versus what we're doing in North America, do you I don't know, do you feel kind of embarrassed, like I do, about how we're kind of superficially trying to use this data to line our pockets versus what they're actually doing in developing nations? You know, from that, is that tracking the spread of malaria to also, education and training and learning where people would never have learned before? Do you feel kind of superficial being here?
I'm very excited about the more sort of altruistic things, but I don't know if I feel. I mean, I think as long as those commercial relationships are transparent and on the up and up, I don't see a problem with it. And I think the really interesting space, what I think from a commercial point of view, is when you look at things like Waze. If you look at the potential to actually combine a useful service to individuals with, you know, something that potentially could make money for the people who design it, with something that actually has a social benefit, that I think is a really, really interesting space. Because what I think is going to happen culturally is that as people start to track their data more, they're going to start to become a little bit more proprietary about their data, right? I mean, once you realize, oh, I can learn all these interesting things about how I read and my exercise patterns and how much I weigh and what I eat and all this other kind of stuff, I think people are going to start to think about if it's worth something to me, what is it worth to other people? What is our data collectively worth? And I think the really great space is if you can think, and there are a lot of really interesting examples of this, of taking something that has an individual value, a commercial value, and a social value. And that, I think, is really going to be the sweet spot as people start to think about the value that their data has. That, I think, has huge potential from a commercial point of view.
Do you think that, I mean, I'm one of these guys that when they ask me for my postal code at IKEA, I always say, okay, so what's in it for me, right? Yes. You know, I'm going to give you some data that's very valuable to you, which is my postal code. It might be just one of the 1 billion you collect every year. But I constantly think about it, right? I think, well, my data, that information is worth something. So how do you think that this plays out when a lot of this stuff is collected anonymously through the carriers, through the browsers that you use, through the location tools that you use? I mean, I use an app called Moves. I rave about this app because while this tracks steps, Moves tracks places and locations and steps as well. But I use it to remember where I've been. But that data sits somewhere in Sweden, in the cloud. And at some point, it's going to be valuable to them. And I constantly think, you know, am I going to be able to make a living off of my data at some point?
Yeah.
Like, do you think that'll happen?
Well, there are people who are arguing for that kind of thing. Jaron Lanier's latest book, what the heck is it called? Who Owns the Future, I think it's called. He's arguing exactly that maybe it's the case that privacy's gone out the window, but maybe we can rejig the system so that we have a series of micropayments, for instance, that can allow people, if not to make a living, at least can supplement their living doing that. So people are making that kind of argument. My feeling about it is that, you know, there's nothing more inherently problematic in gathering data in exchange for a service than in being a television broadcaster and saying, okay, I agree to provide you programming, and the quid pro quo is you agree to, you know, to be exposed to advertising, right? I mean, there's an implicit relationship there. And I think as long as those relationships are transparent, it's not problematic. The challenge, I think, is that, and I'll talk about this in the book, is that we're not yet in that world where we have transparent, clear rules about who's doing what with the data and so on. And partly that, I think there are a number of reasons for that. I think one reason that that's happening is because it's sort of in the nature of startup culture that you think, okay, let's think of the great idea and try and get users, and then we'll figure out how to monetize it afterwards. And if you don't know what you want to do with the data, then it's pretty hard to have a transparent relationship about the data. I think that's one problem. I think another problem is just, and one of the people I talked to in the book, Ian Kerr, talks about this, is that once we're relying only on the standard form contract, the I agree thing, you know, that's not really sufficient. We need to recalibrate that relationship and what the nature of those contracts can be and should be. But then the other piece of the puzzle, I think, too, is that it's almost like a math problem, is that I don't think we quite even know what the math implications of all this stuff is. When you start to put together not just, you know, one data set, when you start to put together 18, 25, 1,000 data sets, what is anonymous and what is not. And there's been some really interesting research that's been done precisely about this. I mean, you probably follow the Netflix example of where
exactly.
they had this thing where it was a contest to improve the algorithms to offer people movie recommendations, and they released this huge anonymous, in quotes, data set of users, and researchers at the University of Texas were able to pair that with another data set and identify not everybody, but they were able to identify some people. So I think there are multiple layers that we have to get sorted out here. But I think the potential, you know, first of all, the genie's out of the bottle, as it were, right? It's pretty hard to sort of roll things back and say, hey, we're not going to do mobile, we're not going to track anything anymore because we're doing it. But also, I think we have to think more clearly about it, because that information can be very useful and it can make our communities run better. It can help us as individuals too. So I think we're just not, it's like I said before, the situation is changing so quickly that the framework around it in some ways I think hasn't quite caught up with that.